What's good, ladies and gentlemen? We got a really good show today. I want to talk about a few things really, really quickly. And, you know, this show has come about just from talking to my gold members and just people in general this week. It's kind of the topic of the week. Today, we're going to talk about five reasons why 90% of the photographers and videographers, you guys, 90% of you who are watching, this is why your niche sucks. We're going to talk about it today. And a lot got to do with you. All right. So before we roll into that, let's roll the graphics. Make sure you hit that like button, hit that subscribe button wherever you're watching. And let's get this show on the road. Let's go.
You're listening to Content and Cash, a Flash Film Academy podcast. If you want to learn how to take pretty pictures, this is not the place. But if you're ready to make a living by learning the business behind the camera, buckle up, because it's time to turn passion into profit with your host, Ty Turner.
What's good? If this is your first time listening to this podcast or on this channel is about understanding and growing the business side of content creation. I'm going to ask that you hit that like button, hit that heart, hit that subscribe button, and post where you're from in the comments. I want to know. I want to see how far people are coming from. We got people all the way from the UK in different places. So I want to know where you're from. Let's talk about it. So without further ado, I want to make sure I get into the five reasons a lot of you guys' niches suck. And let me start with this. A lot of you guys pick niches based off what you wanted to do. And that's not a good look. It's not about what you want to do. It's about what you can sell and who buy it. And number five is really going to dictate why you made the wrong choice. It's going to be a throat punch. Let me put my brass knuckles on. It's going to be a throat punch. Let me first say that this video, like all videos, is brought to you by our Capture and Convert Kit. Sorry, it's going to be a little loud. Brought to you over at FlashFilmAcademy.com. Go check it out. It's too easy payments of $3.99. Five. That's loud, I know. Two ebooks. Go check that out. It's at FlashFilmAcademy.com. All right? Now that we got that out the way, and we get to punch you in your throat about why your niche sucks. All right, let's talk about it, right? Let's talk about why a lot of people fail at having niches and why they niche sucks to begin with, right? A lot of y'all niches are based off, it describes the type of video or photography you want to capture. And your client can't identify with that. I remember last week somebody said, we do green screen interviews where a client is never waking up saying, you know what? I need a green screen interview. A client don't think that way. You think that way. Clients don't wake up thinking about needing interviews. That's not the problem. That's not the problem I would use an interview to solve. Your ability to shoot an interview is your superpower. That is how you would solve this problem, right? You have to diagnose the problem first before you write the solution. You can't just go out here and say, I got the solution. People don't know they got a problem. They don't know that solution fixes their problem. So you have to market yourself differently. And a lot of people don't understand that. So let's talk about number five, right? You don't go three layers deep. You don't go three layers deep on your niche, right? You don't know how to pick a niche. Just like everything else, you kind of half-assed it. And you heard the idea of a niche out here and you decided to jump on it because it was a good idea instead of taking the time to truly understand and obtain information on how to choose the right niche based on your previous experience, your creative expertise, your location, and the equipment you currently own. I know it's a throat punch. You've never taken the time to choose your niche based off those factors. You just said, this is what I think I want to do. And these are things that we talk about like crazy in module one. A lot of people don't, this is why the brain is so important. This is why you can't just read a headline and think you know the story. This is why you can't just be told something and be like, oh yeah, I got it. I got a niche. When you have not properly picked a niche, your niche has, you picked a niche that has nothing to do with your previous experience, with your creative expertise, with your current location and the equipment you own and your current market. You may not be in the market to do what you want to do. You may be in the wrong market for that. Have you done the research to determine whether or not you're in the right niche? Like if you're in the right market for that niche, can that niche be successful in that market? Do you have the background to talk to people about that niche? That's just number five. And that one hurt. I know it burns a little bit. But that's number five. We got four more to go. And I'm going to punch you real quick this week. We're not going to spend 30 minutes talking about this. We're going to spend about 15. Let's go to number four. You never researched your niche because you don't know how to choose a niche. You never learn to see if what you want to sell, people in your area are interested in buying. You never look to see. You just said, this is what I want. This sounds cool. I think I'm going to roll with it. That's what you said. You never took time to look at research if people in your area want what you are wanting to buy. Again, we talk about this like crazy here. There's like 3-4 chapters, one of them including the beta chapter, that talks about who you need to go talk to see if what you're trying to sell even matters. I'm going to be honest, the third layer of your niche, you shouldn't even have until you have a beta client. The third layer of your niche, you don't get to make up. Your beta client makes up for you because you're trying to supply a demand. I want to sell surfboards in Idaho. Yeah, it don't work that way, buddy. You need to go to the coast, or you need to sell a paddle boat or something that works for this area. And a lot of people don't think like that. Not only do they have a video production or a photography item that your client doesn't look at it and see that it solves a problem, but you don't even know if you're in the right place to solve that problem. These are things people do and they fail in this business and they blame it on lack of, they say it was too saturated or nobody's buying. No, you haven't put any effort into growing your business. You're not really trying to do this. You're trying to be lazy about growing your business. You thought this was going to be easy. And it's not. All right, let's go to number three. This is going to be a stinger. You honestly have no experience or know anything about your niche. You chose it because you thought it would make good money. You don't have the ability to walk into a business that's been doing this for years. You can't walk into a business that's been established and around for years and talk their language. And you definitely don't have the ability to teach the business owner anything because you don't know this. You've never researched it. You don't live it. You're not in this industry enough to have these conversations with people who live in that industry. So they don't trust you. There's no way you can come in and do marketing for me and you can't tell the difference between a supercharger and a turbo. You can't tell the difference between this and that. You can't tell the difference between a furnace and an air conditioner. How you doing HVAC marketing? And you don't know the difference between a furnace and an air conditioner. You can't name any top brands of air conditioners or furnaces. You don't know that air filters are bidirectional. Those are things you gotta know. If you are in that industry, you have to have the ability to talk and maneuver in that industry. You cannot do that if you don't know about it. If you just think, hey, that's a good idea. They got money. I'm going to sell to them. It's not going to happen. You're not going to make it. You're not going to make it. Got no nice way of putting it. Let's go to number two. And this is another throat punch because I'm punching you in your throat all day today. Number two is, let's be real. You're truly not interested in your niche. Not only do you not know about it, not only do you not have experience in it, you're not interested in it. You chose it because, again, you thought it would be a great idea and you could make money. You don't have a passion in the industry. which means you don't have a passion in solving problems in that industry. You're not a problem solver. You're a service seller. And business owners don't want to be sold anything. You don't solve problems. You sell services. That's a problem. That's an instant no. That's an instant get out of my face. That's an instant, nah, chief, we ain't going to do it. Or we ain't ready. Or we'll talk to you later. Or don't call us, we'll call you. You are a service seller and not a problem solver. A lot of you guys are service sellers with cameras. You don't solve a problem. You don't even think about your client enough to understand the problems they have. You don't even ask the right questions to put yourself in the client's shoes to begin to understand the problems your client have so that you can solve those problems, because you don't care. Because you're not interested in that niche. And you ain't really here to solve a problem. You're here to sell something. And everybody can smell it. That's why the gatekeepers don't let you in. Everybody here can smell that you're here to sell services and not solve problems. And that's a problem. And as a one-man band, as a small company where every sale matters, the last thing you need to do is walk in there looking like a starving artist. That's the last thing you need to do. Let's go to the last item. Because the last item, oh, it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt big time. The last but not least reason why your niche sucks. And I want you to come close to the camera. Come put the phone real close. Because I'm about to rock your jaw real quick. Put the phone close to you. Right there. Let me line it up right there. Listen. You lack discipline. You lack enough discipline to actually live in the space you create. You're too thirsty for attention. And in business, you jump around to anybody looking to throw money your way, and you're unable to focus on the bread and butter of your business. You lack discipline. So you half-ass got a niche in your head, and you know, you never build your business around it because you spend too much time chasing low-hanging fruit. Because you don't have the discipline to build your brand around your niche. You don't have the discipline it takes to learn it. You don't have the discipline it takes to go get beta clients. You don't have the discipline it takes to be great in that field or be the best in that field, because you're too thirsty chasing low-hanging fruit. And low-hanging fruit gonna be there whether you chase it or not. So you might as well build your brand based off your niche and stop being thirsty and undisciplined. All those layups that you're getting, they will continue to fall in your lap. But you got to build your brand around your niche. How do you market? How do you attract real high-paying clients? There's two types of clients in this world. There's I need it done cheap, and there's I need it done right. When you are going after the low-hanging fruit, you are going after I need it done cheap. When you have a niche, they need it done right. That's why a lot of you say, well, how can you work with clients and not ask the budget? Because my clients need it done right. Your clients need it done cheap. That's why they got a budget. Because they need the budget what they blow on this little bitty problem they're trying to solve with you. Because they don't need it done right. They need it done cheap. That's the difference between your company and my company. My company attract clients that need it done right. They spare no expense on getting the things they need done right because they understand the return on investment. Sometimes greater than you understand it. So a lot of times your niche sucks because you don't have the discipline to do it. And you're everywhere. And you have not saw the benefits of having a niche because you're very rarely there. Because you're all over the place. Because you lack the discipline to focus on your niche. That's a problem. Great question come up about if you don't have previous experience in other industries. You have experience in some industry. We talk about that a lot here. We have tools to help you find what industries are hot in your area. If you don't have experience in it, learn about it. Perfect. Let's go get a beta client and let's go find out about that industry. Let's build a relationship so that we can learn about that industry. You're right. A lot of people don't know about certain industries they want to get into. You have to go and learn about those industries. And if I can trade pictures with a business owner to learn about that industry, that's valuable. Stop listening to these gurus that's telling you to go take pictures for somebody to build your portfolio, and you walk out the door and they got pictures and you got nothing but a portfolio, and you know nothing about that industry. You know nothing about the problems they have. You know nothing about the problems you have the ability to solve. You know nothing about what is it? What is the value of solving that problem, client? What are you saving, or how much money are you making by solving this problem? Those are things you need to know. What does it cost you not to solve this problem, Mr. Client? You're losing $100,000 a year because you're not solving this problem? Would you be willing to pay for a $50,000 video to help you make $100,000? Most of them will say yes. But since you didn't ask the right questions, you will never know. Here you are pushing $2 videos. You're trying to solve $20,000 problems or $2 problems with $20,000 videos, and they not having it. And now you think don't nobody buy, because you went in the door and pushed what you thought was a good idea on them. And because everybody don't want to buy marketing videos or the videos for their website to tell their brand story, because you're this great filmmaker and all you want to do is shoot documentary style videos for your clients to display the company's brand and where they come from. All companies don't need those. You know what a lot of companies need? Video on how to properly install whatever product you bought. Video on explaining why their product is better than the competition. Video explaining how to set up their product, how to break it down, how to return it. Those videos are more valuable to certain clients. But you know what? You've never asked the client. You just assumed. We know how that goes. You need to have these conversations with your client. And if you're not having these conversations with your client or potential client, you're wasting your time. You're wasting your client's time. And that is the direct reason as to why your business is not successful yet in 2024. Because you have not developed a relationship with your ideal client. You have not asked them the questions you needed to know to be successful in business. Because you don't take your niche serious enough. You go after a bunch of low-hanging fruit, and you're everywhere somebody wave a dollar because you're thirsty. You're thirsty for money and business attention. Instead of focusing on your niche and what helps you grow your business. Because you lack discipline. You lack discipline. You lack discipline, and you lack the knowledge to understand what it takes to have a successful niche, because you don't believe in investing in this. You think I just got to pick a direction and walk in that direction and eventually I'll get there. And it don't work like that. Again, let me go over these five really briefly and then I'm out. I told you I'm not keeping you all day. Let me go over these five real briefly. Number five. You don't know how to choose a niche. You've never learned how to choose a niche. You heard somebody, you assumed that was it. You never learned how to choose a niche. You watched a YouTube video, you thought you knew it. You didn't learn how to properly choose a niche. You didn't choose it based on your previous experience, your creative expertise, your location, the equipment that you own, and your current market. You didn't choose a niche based off any of those factors and more, because you thought you knew how to choose a niche. How's that working out for you? This is why you always got to invest in this, people. Very important. All right. Number four, you never researched the niche. Because since you haven't properly learned how to choose a niche, you don't know how to look and see if that niche is valuable in your area, in your market. Can I make money in this area? Are there companies in this area? What do those companies do? Are they million-dollar companies? Are they billion-dollar companies? The companies I want to go after in my area, how many of them are there? Are they two? Is it 200? People waste a lot of time choosing niches because they don't know how to choose a niche. Because they just assume and they never invest in this to learn what makes a good niche. They never invest. Without knowledge, you're absolutely right. I said it once and I said it again. Right now, if you are a photographer or a videographer, and you are not furthering this, you are literally starving to death locked in a grocery store right now in 2024. There's too much content that need to go around for you not to be making money. Period. Let's go to number three again. You honestly have no experience to know anything about your niche. You chose a niche that you thought would get the bag. You didn't choose it because you knew about it. You didn't choose it so a niche that you can walk in the door and have an intelligent conversation with people in that industry. You said, who can I get the biggest bag from? I'm going in that direction. And you're outmatched every single time. Every time you walk in the door to work with a client, you're outmatched. Because of number two. Let's get to number two. You're not truly interested in that industry. You went after the bag. You're not interested in that industry. Fort Campbell, that's what's up. Big shout out to Fort Campbell. So you went after the bag. You didn't go after something. You didn't jump into it's just like a fighter. You got to fight in your weight class first. You can't go after the heavyweight title. You'll get knocked out. You can't jump in a ring with a number one ranked heavyweight boxer if you're a lightweight, if you're a featherweight. You'll get knocked out. And you get knocked out too many times, you won't be able to come back. Let's get to last but not least. You lack discipline. You lack discipline. You're not disciplined enough to live in a space that you are choosing. You fall for every dollar and every bit of attention you get to go film or take low-hanging fruit. You chase low-hanging fruit instead of doing what it takes to establish yourself as a subject matter expert in a market you researched, in an industry you have interest and experience in a niche that is plentiful for your area, because you don't know how to do it. And you don't know how because you never took time to go see how to do it. A lot of people in life fail because of this. They have goals. They want to get there. And they spend 10 hours a day on Netflix. Or maybe YouTube, instead of investing in ways to get to their goals. They think knowledge should be free, but they're willing to pay for entertainment. Help me make that make sense. The knowledge to double your income you think should come for free on a YouTube video, but you're willing to pay $20 a month to see Stranger Things. I'm going to just let that sit in for a minute. Right. Let's just, right. See how dumb that sounds when you really think about it? You rather entertain yourself more than you educate yourself. What did you spend more money this month entertaining yourself or educating yourself? You spend more money on your cable bill, your Netflix, your Peacock, your Max, or did you download more books and listen to more books this month? Because the answer to that question describes your current position. You are exactly where you deserve to be. I'm not going to sugarcoat it for you. Your mama there to do that. I'm not here to sugarcoat it. Your mama here to sugarcoat it. You are standing exactly where you need to stand. Go through your credit card statement this month. How many times have you been entertained? I tell people all the time to get an Audible account. They look at me like I'm crazy. All them people got at least 3 streaming accounts. They got Disney Plus, Netflix, and probably Hulu all at the same time. But look at me for an Audible account, where even when the Audible account closes, you still get to keep the books. They look at me like I'm crazy when I say get an Audible account. You are exactly where you should be based off the decisions that you made in life, or currently make in life, or continue to make in life. As long as you entertain yourself more than you educate yourself, you will be exactly where you are. Everything you need to go from rags to riches is in a book. It's not entertaining. It's not fun. It don't entertain you. The best knowledge for your brain is not entertaining. There is no way to make it fun. There's no way to keep your attention. If it was entertaining and everybody loved it, everybody would be rich and famous. It just, the world don't work like that. The greatest secrets and the greatest advancements in the way you think are put in the most boring places. The world is designed to be that way, so everybody won't go. Because it's easy to get y'all to look at over here at the shiny stuff. It's the dull, boring stuff that helps you make it in this world, that takes you further. There are plenty of YouTube, TikTok, Instagram channels that show you how to make the best, most smooth, acrobatic gimbal shots, that provide you with the most cinematic, beautiful shots you've ever had in life. But those channels aren't showing you how to put yourself in a position where you can charge a client for that. This is the boring stuff. Sam T say, how do you get to the point where your company worked for you and you don't need to work in the business or own the business? And how long did it take you to achieve this? Okay, let me be real with you. If you build it right, you can do it initially. Like, you can start the business off that way. In fact, the way we teach it over at FlashFilm Academy, we teach you to be the project manager. Like, you can find shooters everywhere. Everybody and their mama shoot video. I don't have to be the guy to film it. That's why we talk about, wrong one. That's why we talk about naming your company. Why it's so important to name your company in this module. That's why we talk about things like that. I started my business the way I started my business because I don't want to be out. I've shot 12-hour photography corporate events. I know what it do to your body. As a combat photographer, I know what it do to your body. I'm not 20, bro. I'm in my 40s. I don't want to be down on my knees all day filming, and I don't want to do all of that. You don't have to be that guy. That guy ain't getting paid the most anyway. You should be managing your projects. That's where the money is. Who get paid the most on every movie you watch? The cameraman or the director? Who name do you recognize? Steven Spielberg or John Carpenter? You know the directors. They manage the project. When a movie fails, they don't blame the camera guy. They blame the director, the producers. They get the bag. I am just simply teaching you to be a director within your brand to solve the problems of the companies around you so that you can reap the benefits. That is literally what we teach. That is the FlashFilm Academy system. Literally. That is literally what you learn from FlashFilm Academy as compared to other places. That's telling you to shoot better images to get more clients. As if clients are going to wake up, scroll to your Instagram page, go to the one video you got, and look at that video and say, you know what? My business needs more shots like this. It doesn't happen. It doesn't happen. You don't wake up saying, I need a U-joint. You wake up with a leak under your faucet, under your sink. You wake up to a wet floor. You try to find out, why is my pipe leaking? Who in the area fixed pipes? Who's available? You call a plumber out. A plumber look at it. The plumber determined you need a U-joint or whatever. You don't wake up saying, I need a U-joint. You go through steps to get to where the solution is. You don't wake up with the solution in mind. Are there people that do it? Yeah, few and far between. Just like you wake up one day and say, I'm hungry. You may wake up with a taste for something, but marketing blasts stuff in front of you all day long to sway what you want to eat when you decide that you're hungry or thirsty. So, you know, it's marketing, it's business. Carlos said, one of my biggest obstacles, the hardest obstacles, was learning to let others do camera work so I can handle more of the project management, running the ATEM switcher. I agree. The one thing you will learn, anybody here that's ready to step back and put people in a position, the biggest thing you will learn, and I'm gonna humble you so the world don't have to humble you, is you don't communicate as effectively as you think you do. Your communication isn't as effective as you think it is. So the people you hire, they don't get what you're saying, not because their comprehension level ain't there, it's because sometimes you're not saying it in a way that makes sense to everybody. It makes sense to you, but you weird like that. You always make sense to you, you know, but the person across from you may not get it. So when you first hire people, these are things you have to work on. These are things that you have to get. Chad say, I have for 3 years, I've been specializing in funeral photography, recap videos, funeral montage video services, and I've been booming. There's no one else doing it that I know of other than me. Absolutely, Chad. We had somebody else, wink, wink, I ain't gonna say her name, who was sort of in that industry. And I was telling her, like, yo, it's a blue ocean. Like, you got no competition. The money is there. It's kind of, it's a little cringy, but somebody's got to do it. She said, my only competition is the mortuaries lately, and they've been going, they've been getting upset because the families in my area find me online and bring me in. Absolutely. You got what's called a blue ocean. That means there is no competition. That means you get to create, you get to own the market. It's just a matter of scaling and dominating it at this point. I would scale and dominate. That's dope. That's dope. So, you know, these are things that nobody's going to do it for you. The best I can do is point you to the water. Now, you can be mad at me because whatever. A lot of people mad at me because I got a system. I got a whole app. A lot of people mad at me because it's there. Whatever. Hey, be mad at yourself. Be mad at yourself because you okay with spending hundreds of dollars a month on entertainment and you don't spend nothing on education. And then you're mad at where your life is right now. Just think about that. You're mad at where your life is right now, because you keep making the decision to entertain yourself more than you educate yourself. These are choices that you make. It's just lack of discipline on your part. You are exactly where you're supposed to be. Ain't no luck. Ain't no, well, I could have. I'm so close to. Life don't work like that. Life is about decisions. Small decisions, big decisions. So think about that. Tonight, when you sit in front of that TV and you watch some crap that's on demand that you can watch at a later time. Being a military spouse and having to move often, what's the most practical niche you think works? I love sports. I worked in an agency that did more corporate and real estate. The thing is this, every place you move is going to have real estate and corporate content. Like, they're going to have a need for it. Every place you go, especially as a military spouse, you know, there are, just depends where you're at, really. Because as a military spouse, what happens if you're in Germany? The market is different. What happens if you're in Korea? What happens? I mean, it's different than if you're stationed in Colorado. I think what's great about that is you have you get to practice researching the market and changing your niche based off that market. You'll get good at that. I mean, and that's a skill set to have, because a lot of people never get good at that. You know, it may be, you may have to reinvent yourself every year that y'all move. There are some basic things that I think, you know, every base, you're gonna get family portraits, you're gonna be able to do wedding videography or photography. That's a given. But as far as the B2B side, there are a lot of businesses. Like, I'll give you an example. One of the big businesses that I found that do big numbers around bases are cleaners. Cleaners do top dollar around bases because a lot of guys get their suits cleaned in the cleaners. Cleaners do great around bases. They are everywhere. Like, I would target them. I would target all of those companies that feed on military bases. There's a lot of companies that you only find around big bases. So something to think about. Those are things to think about. Let me just to keep it short. Like I said, super short. You got the five reasons. I can't make it no easier for you guys. I'm laying it out for you. I'm helping you help you. And, you know, every week we're going to continue to do it. If you're watching this, I'm going to ask that you hit the like button, hit the heart, hit the subscribe button. If you're listening to this on the podcast, I'm going to ask that you rate the podcast. Give me them five stars. Give me them five stars. Sam T said one more question. He said, how many people in your course started in their 40s and found success when competing against younger generation of content creators? A majority of people, let me tell you, like, the age thing is not something that holds you back. Let me tell you why. Let me touch on this because I think this is important. Let me tell you why. If you're older and you're listening to this and you're thinking like, man, do I want to go down this rabbit hole? Do I want to learn these new things? Let me tell you the one up that younger people have on older people. Younger people don't flinch at the idea of learning new things. Maybe because they're freshly out of school, they don't flinch at the idea of learning something, right? Whether it be AI, new tools, the system that we have in place, they don't bat an eye at it. Older people bat an eye at the idea of changing, at understanding that their thought process can put them in a totally different place. Older people don't see it. Younger people still see it. They still feel like, I can be something when I grow up, or I can be this when I grow up, or the world is still, I can still get the world. Older people tend to be a little beat by the world and they feel like I'm just going to spend money and do it and nothing's going to change. That's the downside of older people. Let me tell you the pro of an older person that I've noticed. As an older guy, when I walk in there to meet a business owner, every gray hair on my chin helps me do that. I am instantly trusted. When I talk in my niche to my clients, because I am an older guy, I am instantly trusted. You know how difficult it is for a 23-year-old to walk in and talk to a dentist about dentistry? It's just more difficult because they're younger. And that dentist is having that conversation. If anything, they're saying, man, you know your stuff for a young guy. You really know your stuff for a young guy. That's what they're thinking. But if you're older and you walk in and you know your stuff and you say, we've been in business for a while, this is what we do, you're instantly trusted. That's what gray hair gets you. So being older is a benefit as a content creator. Because a lot of business owners you run into and decision makers are older. They instantly trust you, especially compared to some young whippersnapper that's in there with their cameras talking about how they want to take pictures and I'm going to do this and I'm going to have this. And you older guy, you in there shaking hands talking about ROI. How can we increase revenue? How can we provide a return on income? The older you get, the easier the sale get, the harder the shoot get. When you're young, the shoot is easy, the sale is harder. 40s is like 35, 45 is that happy medium. Your body is still in enough shape where you can do the shoot. You ain't hurting too much. And you look old enough where you're respected in that industry. So age it doesn't hurt you the way you, I don't care if you're 60. If a 60-year-old guy walked in and, you know, went up to a doctor and say, I'm here to talk about your marketing and what we can do. You know, it's just a different thing. Older guys are much better at sales. Older guys and ladies are much better at sales. He said, don't matter how much you know, being too young makes you work harder just to be heard or seen. You don't get the benefit of the doubt when you're younger because you don't look like you have the experience. You know what I'm saying? Like, do you trust a 21-year-old bus driver or do you trust a 50-year-old bus driver? Just, we ain't even got to go further than that. I trust a 50-year-old bus driver because I assume he got 35 years of bus driving. That 21-year-old, you're like, how long this dude been driving? 5 years? Young folks don't think like that, but older folks definitely think like that. I'm telling you, as a guy that's in his 40s, yeah. When I get in the Uber and my driver is 20-something, I'm not chilling that tough. When I got an old guy, I may lay back and doze off. When I got a 21-year-old in a Tesla, I'm watching everything. Because this dude is texting. He's doing everything. He's chatting. He's having conversations. He's swiping on Tinder. He's doing everything. That's all I'm saying. So if you're older, it helps. It helps. Carlos said, grades keep them in business. So these are just little things. And again, look, these questions that you guys have, which are great questions, these are the questions that we talk about over in the community. These are things where iron sharpens iron. A lot of the members can answer these questions and we have these conversations because you're not the only person that think like this, that have these questions. This is why community is so important. This is why it's so important to be around a group of like-minded individuals like yourself who can talk about these things. Hey, who's located in this area? Who has success in this niche? I'm having a problem here. Hey, we did this and that worked out. We did that and that worked out. You got to be around people who understand you, every part of you, right? And your niche, let me bring this old slide I keep saved up here. Your niche, I don't know why it just went on there, but your niche should cater to those five. Your niche should catch you in part one of that. Part one of that is where your niche should catch you at. In the buying stage, all right? With that being said, I'm going to see y'all in the next video. All my members, I will see you live tomorrow in our accountability meeting where we go over things like this and more. And we have these conversations. We do it every week. If you're not a member, we invite you to join FlashFilm Academy. Sign up. Join the family. Let's do this. Everybody else, hit the like button. Hit the share button. And I will see y'all in the next video.
You've been listening to Content and Cash, a Flash Film Academy podcast. Make sure to subscribe to the YouTube channel and go to our webpage at www.flashfilmacademy.com.